All right, can you hear me? Or yes or no? Let me see the... It's not on, right? No, I think it is on. Can you hear me in the back? Is that better? Okay, thank you. All right, so thank you for staying for the last talk of the day. So this is another talk about density estimation for multivariate low concave densities. I'm going to explain what they are. It joint work with my postdoc, Alistair Stewart, Tasso Sidiropoulos, and his student, Tim Carpenter. Okay, so let's begin. So like explaining the title, so this work gives the first finite sample upper bound for the maximum likelihood estimator of multivariate low concave densities. So these are densities on R to the D. Previously, for up to three dimensions, we knew the answer. For more than three dimensions, no finite sample upper bound was known. In particular, the bound we actually prove is essentially tied up to a 1 over epsilon factor. So the setting is, again, the classical density estimation setting. So we get samples from a density that is assumed to belong in a class. We want to output a hypothesis that's close with respect to some metric. For this talk, the metric is going to be the Hellinger distance, which I'm reminding you how it's defined here, Hellinger square. Okay, so now an important sort of context slide here is that whenever we have a problem like that, we need some assumption about the family of distributions where the samples come from. Okay, so otherwise, it's easy to prove that no finite sample is possible. And usually what people have done in statistics is to assume some kind of shape restriction on the density. For example, this one is a monotone density, this one is a low concave density. And under those assumptions, try to design sample and computationally efficient algorithms. Now, this is a quite old area in statistics. Since the 50s, people have worked on it. And they've worked on many different families of shape restrictions. The standard tool, at least in the branch of statistics that we're focusing on here, is the maximum likelihood estimator. So people are trying to analyze how many samples it needs until it converges and how fast can we compute it. Now, the family we're focusing here is a family of low concave densities. If you don't know what they are, the word really that reveals it. So it's a distribution whose density is of the form exponential to the phi, where phi is concave. So this is a non-parametric family that generalizes many familiar families of distributions, like Gaussian, exponential, etc. And for that reason, it has been very appealing in inference. It's much more flexible than just assuming that your data comes from a parametric family. So it can really model more complicated things. So at the structural level, it has been studied also in computer science theory and geometry. In terms of prior work, so what do we know? Okay, so this problem, the problem of density estimation for low concave densities, has been studied extensively, both in statistics, mathematical statistics, and more recently computer science theory. So now for one dimension, for the univariate case, we understand exactly what is the rate of convergence, how many samples you need to learn. So we have minimax, upper and lower bounds that are matching. And we also have computationally efficient algorithms that do this. On the other hand, for higher dimensions, in particular, again, I'm considering the dimension to be a fixed constant. We know much less. In particular, there has been an interesting line of work in statistics, establishing a global consistency for the maximum likelihood estimator. And the most relevant prior works are these two. So the paper, a paper by Kim and Samworth in the Annals of Statistics a few years ago. So they have two results. The first one is an analysis of the sample complexity of the maximum likelihood estimator for at most three dimensions. So for at most three dimensions, they give an upper bound on the sample complexity, which is tied up to logarithmic factors. And they also prove a sample complexity lower bound for any estimator. And this is their the lower bounds. And last year, in a paper with Alistair Stewart, who is a co-author in this paper, and Daniel Kane in this conference, we showed that there is a different estimator, very different than the maximum likelihood, that has sample complexity which is comparable. So basically, it scales like 1 over epsilon to the d plus 5 over 2, and the lower bound is d plus 1 over 2. So there is a 1 over epsilon square gap between the two, but at least the exponents are kind of similar as a function of d. So this is what we knew, and the main result of this paper is an analysis of the MLE. We actually show that the MLE has this sample complexity in every dimension, in particular in dimensions 4 and above. This is the first result. And based of the, because of the lower bound by Kim and Samworth, this sample upper bound is actually optimal up to a 1 over epsilon factor. Okay, ideally, we'd like to remove that factor, but at least now we know something for any fixed dimension. Okay, now how do we prove that? I mean, the proof is not easy, but there is a key lemma I'd like to share with you. So what does it say? So let F0 be a low concave density on R to the D. Suppose that the sample size N is large enough. Then with high probability over the samples drawn from F0, for any convex set simultaneously, we have that the probability that F0, the true density, gives to the convex set is close to the probability that the empirical, so F sub n is the empirical with n samples, gives to this convex set. So note that the right-hand side goes to, has a log n, so log sample size in the denominator. This is actually significant. So why is this useful? I mean, the observation is that the super-level sets of low-concave densities, so the sets of points where the density is at least something, are actually convex. So what we can do via some manipulations after we have the lemma is to actually use it to analyze the error in the log likelihood of low-concave density. So really, the lemma is the key result that we need. After we have it, then some analysis gives us that the MLE works with these many samples. And now, how do we prove that? Well, the idea is, again, to use some... So we'd like to reduce it to an application of the Weiss inequality, which is some result from empirical process theory. Roughly speaking, it says that if you have a family of distributions whose distinguishing sets have low Weiss dimension, then you can learn with number of samples proportional to the Weiss dimension. So what we want to do, we want to approximate any convex set C by a family of sets that has low Weiss dimension. We want the same family to apply to every convex set, otherwise it would be trivial. So what we do is that we use a result from convex geometry that says that you have any convex set, you can approximate it from inside and the outside and outside by a convex polytope that has a relatively small number of facets. And basically, the approximation is going to be multiplicative with respect to volume. So the volume difference is going to be something like a parameter, like some delta times the volume of C. So after we have these results, we can actually apply the Weiss inequality because polytopes with a small number of facets have a low Weiss dimension, and actually get that F0, the true density, and Fn, the empirical density, are close to each other with respect to both the inner and the outer approximation. The thing that we actually need is, in fact, that they're close on C, so this is not immediate. And the way we do that, at the end of the day, it reduces to proving that the volume of the difference between the inner and the outer approximation is small. So, like, this is the actual convex set, this is the inner approximation, this is the outer approximation. We want to show that actually it suffices to show that the volume of the difference is small. So this is obviously not going to be true if we actually start by approximating C, because C can have infinite or arbitrarily large volume. And the approximation is of the sort of the inner and outer approximations have error, like which is multiplicative with respect to volume. But there is an easy way out. So we just intersect C with a set S that contains essentially all the samples. And we know by concentration that this set S is not going to have too much volume because low concave distributions are basically have fast decaying tails. Basically, that's it. So now if you do this thing, you're going to get a lemma qualitatively similar to what I stated here, but the sample size is going to be a little bit worse than this function. To actually get the right lemma, you need something more complicated, but I'm not going to go into that. And so this is as much math as I'd like to describe. So open questions. So there is reason to believe that, and this has been observed by statisticians, that in fact the log concave MLE might actually not be sample optimal when the dimension d is bigger than 3. That's an open question. I actually believe that it is, and we need a different analysis. The obvious open problem for computer scientists is if there is a polynomial time algorithm to compute the MLE in d dimensions. So the obvious algorithm with n samples in d dimensions has time n to the d. Okay, so can we do poly nd? And I think also it should be true, but it requires some algorithmic work. And finally, there's something called adaptivity. In particular, what if the underlying distribution, the underlying log concave distribution you're trying to learn is simpler? Let's say it's not a worst case log concave density. Can you prove better sample and time properties for the MLE? So in one dimension, these types of things are known, but even in two dimensions, we don't know the answer. And at this point, I think I'm going to conclude.
I think in the interest of time, I would just thank, like everyone to thank all the speakers in the session. See you at the poster session.